Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Today we are talking about an RC normalizer for normalizing and alignment the input circuit of an oscilloscope. It's a very small device here, one resistor, one capacitor, not more. We will discuss a little bit about the principle, the function and how to build it, how to align it and later how to use it when aligning or adjusting the input circuits of an oscilloscope. How does such a normalizer work? What's the principle? We have here an oscilloscope. It's an input circuit here. Typically we have an input resistance of 1 mega ohm here and the parallel capacity, let us assume 20 picofarad, maybe 25 or 30 picofarad, depending upon the scope. This is an equivalent circuit of the input and here is a gain with the steps, 10, 20, 50 millivolt and so on, where the steps are adjusted. This amplifier here is assumed as ideal and the components here represent the actual input resistance, RI and parallel capacity. So we can forget this one here and focus on this input here. The culprit, the problem sometimes is the capacity here, because when aligning the input stages, the attenuated stages from 1, 2, 5 steps, you know these steps of a scope, it is assumed that this input capacity is constant, but it isn't always constant. Sometimes it changes a little bit from, let me say, 20 picofarad, 19, 21, then it is 20 again and so on. And it is very difficult to align it that always exactly 20 picofarad is occurring here. How can we check it? The principle is a normalizer here. We have here, it's also a so-called divider 2x1. 1 mega ohm, 20 picofarad. We also have here 1 mega ohm, as precise as possible, plus minus 1% or better. And in parallel, we have here capacity. Best is to have a variable capacity, not a fixed one. And this capacity here should be then exactly this capacity here. This resistor here is this resistor, and this capacity is this capacity. With 1 mega ohm and 20 picofarad, we have here a time constant of 20 microseconds. And this normalizer here should also have 20 microseconds. And if it is properly aligned, then this capacity is identical to this capacity on the square wave. The input square wave here is transferred to the screen. Perfect. No overshoot, no distortion, nothing. You know this principle when aligning probes. That's a square wave from a generator. Typically it has 50 ohms and a range of 1 or 2 kilohertz. It must be considerably lower than this time here. If we have a time constant of, let me say, these 20 microseconds, so we have to wait at least some 100 microseconds to settle down here and to have a reference to see, okay, there's an overshoot or a negative overshoot here. Yes, I don't know the word. So we have to come to the line. So at least, let me say 1 millisecond, 500 microseconds, 1 millisecond is good. And this is a range of 1 or 2 kilohertz. It's a 50 ohm generator typically. So we need a termination feed through or a resistor in the normalizer, also with 50 ohms. The principle is that either we can use this trimmer here to align for optimum response here. And if there's a scale on it, a small scale, then we can read the input capacity. Or the other possibility is when we have here set to a specific or specified capacity and we switch through the attenuator steps here, then in all steps the square wave response should be equal. We have to, of course, to adjust here the generator amplitude, because we have here divider 2x1, 50% of the input voltage here is lost. So this is the principle of the RC normalizer, because this normalizer normalizes this input here to this one, and so we have an equal value, and we can see what happens in the input of the scope. And now, how to build such a normalizer. The schematic is very simple. From the square wave generator, we have an input BNZ connector here. I've chosen two resistors, 100 ohm in parallel. So we have here exactly 50 ohms. It's important to have here a perfect termination. And this value has to be very, very low compared to 1 megohm. And in parallel, we have a small variable capacitor in the range of, let me say, 10 to 40 picofarad. It's not absolutely necessary. Maybe it's also good to have 5 to 30 or so, but whatever you think you need to your, with regard to your scope you have. But in general, we should be in this range here. Important is to connect the rotor side of the trimmer here to the low impedance side, because such capacitors here, I've used here a small capacitor like this one here, they often tend to move very hard, and it's necessary to need a screwdriver with metallic blade, because plastic or ceramic screwdrivers will break or will be damaged. And when you use a metallic part here, then it's a danger that you misalign it simply by touching it with the screwdriver. To avoid this effect, the rotor here, the rotor side here, has to be connected to the low impedance side here. Then you can touch it here. We will see later it on the scope, and nothing happens. If you would connect this side here to the other side here and you touch it here, you have a problem, because you have here an impedance of 1 megohm, or let me say 500 kiloohms, with a scope in parallel and a very low capacity input, only some picofarads as we know. So the danger is very high that you push a screwdriver on it, adjust it, remove it, then it's wrong again, you go in and so on. You will never be ready, and you will be will become crazy. So this rotor to this side here. This is the construction, the physical construction of the normalizer. We can see here, I hope you see it on the picture, two resistors on both sides here of the incoming signal of the BNZ jack here. Here is a capacitor. Below the capacitor is a resistor, 1 megohm here. And this here is the output. It's only an adapter here. This adapter, of course, is needed to connect it to the scope. So let me bring it back again here. If you have a look at the capacitor of the trimmer here, you see there is a scale on it. Can I make it a bit bigger here? Ah, yes, okay. Ah, come on. And here is a small marker or a pointer on it. And when I tune it here, this pointer moves here to the measured capacity. It starts with 20, it's 15 picofarad here, 20, 30, 40 picofarad. That's the tuning range. It is specified 10 to 40 here. On the print here, it says 10 to 40, so it's 15. I've not calibrated the 10 one here, only the 15 one here. Of course, I did it outside this normalizer here. The trimmer was connected directly to a picofarad meter, a very small picofarad meter, which is well suited for low capacitances, measuring starting with 1 picofarad. Resolution is, I think, a tenth of picofarad. So such a trimmer can be aligned and calibrated very easy. And then I brought it back into the circuit here. It's not good to check the capacitance, of course, here inside. You would have a wrong measurement. That's it. Quick simple. And I think everyone who has a picofarad meter can build it. The resistor, Megohm resistor, I've checked it with an ohm meter for very less error, for tolerance better than 1%. I think I have here 1 promille or so. I've checked it with a precise ohm meter. So this thing is ready here now for operation. This is a setup for testing the normalizer here. Here is a scope. It's the same scope I have repaired in the last video sequences. Maybe you remember, you can have a look at it. I've connected a square wave generator here. The square wave generator is a little bit too good for the purpose here, but I have no worse generators. It has a rise time of approximately 6 nanoseconds, set to 1 kHz output frequency here. The duty cycle is exactly T and a half. It's 50% duty cycle. So you see exactly 50% here. Output attenuator, the amplitude can be selected between lower than 0.5 volts down to down to nearly zero and up to 10 volt. In the very low amplitude ranges here, or sensitivity ranges of the scope, it's necessary to use an additional attenuator. It's 20 dB here. Here's a feed-through attenuator again, so the square wave is perfect. And now we will use this normalizer and see what happens when I connect it to the input of the scope here. The scope here is specified with 20 picofarad here, 1 megohm and 20 picofarad input capacity, and we will see what happens when I use this trimmer here, and then I can compare the different input settings of the attenuator here and see what happens with the input capacity. In the first step, I have to check whether this normalizer is really a divider 2x1. I've set an input signal at a sensitivity of 10 millivolts per division, 50 ohm termination, 20 dB, set the amplitude here, so we have a display height of exactly 6 divisions here. Maybe a little bit more intensified. And now when I replace this feed-through termination with this normalizer, there's also a termination in it, 50 ohms. But additionally, we have a resistor in series of 1 megohm, so the display height should be half. Instead of 6, we should have 3 divisions in the vertical. So I remove this. Remove this to the scope. Connect it and connect it. And what a surprise. We exactly have 3. We can center it a little bit better. So that means the 1 megohm is 1 megohm. And the trimmer here is nearly a perfect set. I've made it before I connected it. I made a small test here, of course. And then I can show you what happens when I switch through it here. But I make a little bit better screen resolution here and move the camera. The scope is at the maximum sensitivity of 2 millivolts per division. I've reduced the input level here of the scope, of course, the output 0.5 volt and nearly zero here. And we see it's a good square wave, perfect square wave. And the scale here, as I can see, shows me 26 picofarad here. I have to subtract some picofarad for this adapter here. And for the BNC check, we will check, see what even those adapters here will cause an error, because they have also some picofarad. Now I go to the next step here. Increase the voltage again a little bit. I think it's still okay here. Go to 10 millivolt here. Go to the next. Okay. there is a small rounding here to be seen, and now I can look at what the input capacity is. I have to adjust it here a little bit for better. Oops, that was it. Now I have a little bit more than 25. It's less than 1 picofarad I've changed here. It's a very nearly no change here to come to this solution here. When I go back, now I have a little bit of an overshoot. So the difference between these two stages here is, as I can read it on the trim pot here, it's nearly exactly 25. Yeah, it's 25 here, and it was a little bit more than 25. So it is a minimum variation of capacity here. The scope here is specified with an input capacity of ±1 picofarad. You cannot expect with such a concept here of the scope that the input capacity is absolutely constant over the whole range. There is a small variation because not every step here is aligned during the alignment process. You have step 1, 2, 5, which are aligned, and then 10, 20, 50, and so on. So there are only a few trimmers, and it is assumed that when different stages are connected here together with the attenuator, that the input capacity is constant. It is not constant because the switch has different settings, different contacts, which have also a little bit of capacity, and you see 1 picofarad more or less, and you have a distortion here. So you can't expect a perfect alignment here. But we go to the next one here. Okay, here's a little bit of rounding here. Now I have 26. Next step here. And this was too much here, as expected. I go down here. I have again 25 and something. Next step is 0.1 volt. I will take out the attenuator here. It's easier for me here. volt per division, it's okay. 0.2, yes, it's also okay here. 0.5, very small overshoot here. I will reduce it a little bit, okay, then it's good, okay. So it's not okay here. There's another effect here. I'm now in the range 25 point any something here. Okay, this was a little bit too much here. I see here's another effect here which cannot be aligned absolutely perfect, but we're always in the range of 25 to 26 picofarad here. 1 volt, 2 volt. It's 5 volt here. Sorry, I have no more output voltage here. It's the end of the of the generator here. And 50, but it looks also good. Okay, what can I say here regarding the scope? The input capacity is always in the range of 25 to 26 picofarad measured with this one here, but I have to subtract this adapter here because there are also some picofarad inside, and also the circuit here has, the BNC jack here also has 1, 2, or 3 picofarads, and I will show it on the next experiment. I will add an additional adapter here in it, make it a little bit longer here, and you see what will happen here. You see here, the scope is perfectly aligned here. This normalizer also shows again 25 picofarad here. That's the setting here. And now I add on this side here this adapter. It's a male and a female adapter. You can see it, male and female adapter, simply in series. One moment, so you can follow what I'm doing. I only remove it here. Add this adapter, bring it back again. And maybe you don't believe what you're seeing, but we have a heavy distortion here. It's of course no problem. I will adjust here the normalizer. We have now 25 picofarad. I will look for a new compensation. Now we have the same picture as before. And now I have a capacity of rather exactly 30 picofarad. This is 30 picofarad, that means this adapter here, or these two adapters, brought additionally 5 picofarad into the circuit here. So I had to increase the resistance, the capacity here, by 5 picofarad. When I remove it here, the additional two adapters connected in, guess what happens? Yes, of course, we will have an overshoot. That's it. Because we are overcompensated here. And now I can go back. Oh, that's not so good here. Let's take this one here. We are back again here in the perfect setting, and we have again 25 picofarad here. So these two connectors here brought totally 5 picofarad. So I assume each of these adapters here have 2.5 picofarad. And additionally, I have here such a double male adapter here, which also adds 2.5 picofarad to the circuit. So when I read here on the scale of this trimmer here, 25 picofarad is input capacity, I have to subtract also these 2.5 picofarad from this result here. So I come to the 22.5 picofarad as input capacity. And additionally, I have a BNC jack here. It also has 1 or 2 picofarad, not only the adapter here. Please remember, I've calibrated this capacitor outside the circuit here, not inside, outside the circuit here. So I come very, very close to the specified 20 picofarad here. This is very necessary to have it always in mind that these adapters also cause an error. It is not so problematic because it's not an absolute measurement. It's a relative measurement. That means we want to see the change of the capacity here when we choose several settings. And of course, we will make a comparison between channel A and B. And now I switch to channel B here. Bloop. Triggering to B. Keep fingers crossed. I should make a better. Okay, it's not so perfect. There is a little bit of difference here. Again, to prove it. And this was not more than 1.5 picofarad more. So the difference here between these two channels is in this setting here, 1.5 picofarad difference. And now let's compare the two channels here. Again, we have the setting 0.2 volt here, an input signal aligned, and then I go to channel B here. I simply move it to the other side here. Shows channel B here, triggering is A and B. You see it is not perfectly, should be a little bit realigned here. I will do it. But it's only a minimum adjustment. It's roughly, let me say, 1 picofarad is a difference here. It's not a big issue here. Ah, okay, and you see what happens when I go one step down here. So I was a little bit overcompensating here and I have to go back here. Now I'm in the same position here as before. Again, 25, 1 picofarad less. This is the same position here, 0.1 volt per division. It's also okay here. Oops, it's a little bit overdriven here. But you see also the other channel here is nearly perfect. That's okay here. We're always in the range of plus minus 1 picofarad for both channels, so I think it's very good. And also the coincidence here, let's check it. Here we have 20 millivolt. I go here also to 20 millivolt just to compare it. Where we are here with this setting range. Okay, you see it's not absolutely perfect. I have to realign it a little bit here. Oops. This is also less than 1 picofarad difference here. As I said in the beginning of this alignment sequence here, of this checking sequence, such a concept here is not able to deliver the perfect alignment of the step attenuators here. You have always to expect a little bit differences from step to step due to the mechanical construction here. A difference of plus minus 1 picofarad here is always given. It has to be accepted, but I think it's not critical in practical measurements. When you use a probe here like this one, and connect it to the input, you always have to align this probe here with a calibrator here. There's a calibrator output or a separate square wave generator. Okay, that was it regarding this topic, RC normalizer. You can find some more pictures on my website. You will find it when you go to the description here of the video. I have a link to my website. There's also a short description and the schematic again, and some photographs, some detailed photographs. Any question, please contact me, but I think it's not so difficult and you can build it yourself. You see, it's a very nice and simple feature here, unit here, but it helps a lot when you're aligning scopes or testing scopes, checking scopes regarding the input capacity and input resistance. See you later, next video.